children. We are adopted as your own. No condemnation, we are forgiven. Nothing can take us from your love.
I am redeemed.
Raised with my Savior Christ. Fear overcome, I will be glorified. You will forever defend and stand beside. I am safe in your love. Oh, we cry, Father, we are your children. We are adopted as your own. No condemnation. Nothing can take us from your love. Creation awaits the glorious day. We are forgiven. Nothing can take us from your love. Creation awaits the glorious day when Jesus returns and trials will fade.
Today we will be reminded to be strong in these last days, no matter what comes and what lies ahead. Psalm 27 reminds us, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advanced against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army beseech me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. I will remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, take heart, and wait for the Lord." Let's sing this morning with undivided hearts. Thank you, Ben.
Give me an undivided heart. Teach me to walk in righteous paths and follow in your ways. For you are gracious and forgiving. Hear, O Lord, and answer me. me an undivided love for all that you desire. Make me a living sacrifice. Ignite me in your fire. For you, O Lord, our God eternal, all my ways are known to you. Undivided, I want to live for you. Single-minded, all that I say, all that I do, sanctify me. Take me and make me new, that I might live for Christ my Lord. Undivided, counting my gains as loss, single-minded, whatever the pain, whatever the cost, for him who died for me.
Wow, that was beautiful. I feel like I'm in a jazz club of sorts. Sorry, back to church. Take a seat. Now, I've got some lovely helpers, and while I come up, I want to welcome our online viewers this morning. Yoo-hoo, welcome online. We love having you here. Let us know you're here. And I just wanted to see if Susanna is here around this morning. Is she here? Oh, there she is. Welcome, Susanna. I brought your picture up with me. Susanna's here. She's one of our missionary supports that we support through Wycliffe in the Indigenous community. So say hi to her and have a chat this morning with her. It's great to have you with us. Now, I've got my little helpers here. I think I turned this on. Is it on already? Jeremy's going to do the magic. Yeah, we're good to go. Come on up, helpers. Okay, so we'll put you guys up there first, and then Lucy in the middle, and then Dom and Hosea here. Now, who knows what this is? Kids, come down the front, if you're not already down the front, by the way. Come on down. Who knows what this is? What sort of spoon, Alice? A teaspoon, that's the clue. It's a teaspoon. Now, if I hold this one up, what is this?
A plastic spoon.
It is a plastic spoon. Thanks for the clarification there, Isaac. That's good. It's a bit of a grotty one, actually. But is it a teaspoon? Yeah, this one is. And when you see this one, what are you usually doing?
Baking.
People out there, yeah, baking. Dominique's the baker up here, obviously, to know that. And what letters do you see in your ingredient book when you see this? What letters do we call, do you know? Let's have a look at our T and our S, say them together, and our P. And what does that mean? Yeah, so then when I look at that in my bakery book, I go, oh, I've got to go and get my teaspoon out and get a teaspoon of sugar to make the medicine go down or something like that. So what are we now? What it's communion this morning, and I want us to pray together because it's great to talk to God, isn't it? It's so good to talk to God, and who forgets to talk to God sometimes? And who gets distracted and forgets and does other things? Yeah, I know Dominic talks about this. And who just, oh, you just put it on your lower priority and you forget. But it's great to talk to your best friend, isn't it? And to chat to them. And if you don't get to talk to them, you don't get to share what's going on in your life or to find out who they are and who they want you to be. When we talk to Jesus, that's what we're learning as we talk to him. So I thought we'd do some prayers before communion this morning. So when we say our tea prayer, thank you, dear Abby, what do you reckon that stands for? What word do we say when we pray to God? Pippa? Oh, you've got to say that out really loud for us.
Thank you.
Oh, can we see if it's thank you, Abby? Hold it up. Oh, is that thank you? Yeah, it is. Woohoo. And when we get to S, what do you think we're saying? Yeah.
Sorry.
Oh, that's brilliant. Sorry. Are we saying sorry? Yes, we are. And the last one, P, what do you think we say? Anyone else got a little go?
Please.
Please. Beautiful. Bella and Alison, Isaac have the magic for praying. That's great. Well, it's not magic, actually. It's just the ingredients for praying. Thank you, sorry, please. So what we're going to do, and we hold this up too, it says thank you, sorry, please. So when my kids were little, we had a little sign up that looked like this, and after dinner or whenever, before bed or sometime, this is how we'd pray. We'd say a little prayer together. So we're going to say a prayer together, and our friends here are going to pray, help us to pray, okay? And we're thinking particularly at communion, what prayer do we pray particularly? Does anyone know which one of these do we pray?
Sorry.
Sorry. Why do we pray sorry? Do you know? Put you on the spot there.
Because we're sorry for our sins.
Yeah, that's right. And who came to take them away?
Jesus.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why we come to communion, to remember what he's done for us. Brilliant. Okay, so let's say a prayer. I'm going to give you the mic, guys, and you can pass it along. And let's pray.
Thank you for Easter time and Jesus' love for us, for our church family, for friends and all good things.
Thank you for all your promises to us, to be with us, love us, forgive us and provide for us as your people, in your place, for your purpose.
Sorry when we make poor choices, don't love ourselves or others like you do, Jesus, and forget to spend time with you.
Forgive us, we are so easily distracted to be lovers of ourselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, disobedient, ungrateful, unforgiving, without love. Most merciful God, we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed by what we have done and what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart or our neighbours as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent.
Please help us to trust and follow you each day, to make good choices and share your love with our friends.
Please protect, guide, teach, strengthen and change us to be more like Jesus. Grant us a heart of trust and faith, seeking your purpose, sharing your love and truth with the people we meet in our community. Amen.
Thank you to our friends, to Sarah and Abby and Lucy and Hosea and Dominic. Give them a little clap for being brave and praying. So as you go about your prayer, you might want to remember that little teaspoon prayer as you go. Be blessed. And so now dear Eliza's coming up and she's going to share with us some good stuff. Thanks, Eliza.
Thanks, Jenny. Thanks, everybody. Good morning. As Jenny said, my name is Eliza. I have the huge privilege of being on the Tiny Church team. And this morning, I'm going to give you a little bit of an insight into Tiny Church. This is our 11th session of Tiny Church this week. And I can tell you, it has been so much fun. And the team are honestly awesome. So your kids are in very good hands. So what is Tiny Church all about? Tiny Church, as a team, we get the great privilege of exploring with these little people and giving them their first taste of the Kids Church community. What a great blessing that is. And we get to partner with parents as we teach these little people about the Bible, about the God who made them and who loves them and who saves them. We're not following the same teaching program as the adults. Our kids' church do that and our little church do. But in Tiny Church, because they are our tiniest people, we have our own two-year curriculum where we're going through some of those real foundations of Christianity that then will get built on and built on as they go through our kids' church ministry, which is fabulous. The way we do it is we have a theme for the term. We have a key saying, and we say that saying, multiple times every single week. Because these people are little, we want to give them the best chance to remember that truth so that they can carry that truth with them, hopefully, for the rest of their life. We have a song and a rhyme that goes with that theme, and then every week we teach a different story from the Bible and do a craft that reinforces that theme. So this term, the kids are learning, Jesus is the King who saved the world. Can you do it with me? Jesus is the King who saved the world. And our little people hear that multiple times every week. And Gus, by about week three, I could say, who's Jesus? And you'd go, world. Okay, he's got some of it. He doesn't have all the words yet, but he's also not even two. So I think we're doing pretty well that if our kids before the age of 2 and 3 are learning that Jesus is the King who saved the world, that is a beautiful thing. Now, hidden around the room, I have some of these eggs. There should be 11 of them. Kids, even adults, if you want to, have a look around under the chairs next to you. If you find an egg, can you bring it up for me? You can come up, stand on stage, spread out along so we can see the beautiful eggs. Do you want to hold the donkey, Ali? Oh, thanks, Lisa. Well done. Hop on up. Well done. Spread out along. 1, 2, 3, 4. We're getting pretty close. Oh, I run from the back. Yes, 2 more coming. Perfect. Yeah, great job. Stand there. So this term, as we've been learning that Jesus is the King who saved the world, we've been doing the Easter story broken down into little weeks. So we started with Jesus riding his donkey into Jerusalem and we got all the way up to his death and resurrection. And we've got a few weeks left where we will see what happened once Jesus was alive and how he went to heaven. And all of this reminds our kids that Jesus is the King who saved the world. Well done. What else they do is these big stickers have been stuck on our wall in Hall 2 with blue tack. Sorry, it's okay, we're not destroying the walls. But our little people get their own mini matching sticker. Whatever goes on the wall, they get their own little one. And they've learnt pretty quick that this is what happens, so there will be stickers for every term from now on. But it's a great little cue for you, for who are the people in Little Church? I mean, in Tiny Church, sorry. Little Livy on the end is one of our beautiful tiny churches. She'll be one of the ones who has one of these stickers after church. If you see someone with one of these stickers, why don't you point out their sticker to them? They love them. They're very exciting. Point them out to them and see if you can connect with them this week or any week about what they're learning about Jesus, the King who saved the world. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the God of all people and nations and ages. Thank you for the children and young people you have blessed our church with and for their fabulous leaders. Please be with them this morning as they head out. May they learn and have a great time together. Amen. Just stay there holding your eggs for me, team, while I explain where we're going. If you do have someone in Tiny Church, aged 18 months to 3-year-olds, we're heading into Hall 2. Follow the red shirts. If your little person is aged 4 to kindergarten, follow the green shirts out to Hall 3. Year 1 through to year 5 are going into Hall 1 with the yellow shirts. And then our teenagers from year 6 to 9 will meet up the back and head out to their program. You guys, you can give me your eggs and we'll head out. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
Good morning, all. How great it is to see you today and how great it is to see our young children in church. It's great until they go out, then there's this humongous gap at the front. But it's just so joyful, isn't it, to have children with us in the service and to know that they're being well cared for in their programs as well. If you're visiting with us today or if you're new amongst us, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. We'd love to connect with you after our service at morning tea. We'd love to find out more about you and help you connect to St. Matt's as well. Well, just like we have lots of young children, we have a number of youth in our church. And as many of you will know, in just 3 weeks' time, they're going up to KICK up at Katoomba for their camp. A number of you have helped through providing a car to be washed, help raise funds for that. But now we're wondering if you might also be able to help by praying over the course of that weekend. John Batten, our youth minister, his vision for it is that every minute of that weekend is being covered in prayer by people from our church. And if that is something you'd like to be a part of, that's something I'd like to be a part of, then you can sign up for a half-hour slot where you're committing to pray for the young people as they're up at Katoomba. And you can do that by signing up on one of the clipboards. I think currently they're out near the kitchen in that little foyer on your way outside. But Eliza, who you saw up here just a moment ago, she will have those clipboards after the service and be coming around. So if you want to sign up, look out for Eliza or find those clipboards, and that would be a great way to support that ministry by praying over the course of that weekend. A little bit later in May, towards the end of May, on the 26th of May, we're having what we're calling our Commitment Sunday. And this Sunday is an opportunity for people who have come to faith or who want to re-express that faith, recommit themselves, an opportunity to do that. And so at the very least, we will have in our 6 p.m. service baptisms and confirmation that Sunday. If there's enough people who want a baptism or a recommitment on Sunday morning, then we may do it on in the morning service as well. But if you're interested in being involved in that, if you haven't been baptized and would like to be baptized or confirmed, or if you do want to make a recommitment of faith, then please talk to one of the pastoral team and we'll give you some more information about that. That's coming up on the 26th of May. We're wanting to engage with that early because we do want to help people who particularly want to be baptized or confirmed think about what they're doing. And so we've got a foundations course for people to move through to help them think about that. All right. It's great to have new people amongst us. Sometimes we also have to say farewell to those who have been amongst us but are moving on for one reason or another. And this morning is one of those sad days. And so I'm going to invite Jenny Fuller to come forward as we hear from Jenny and as we then are able to pray for her as she moves on. Would you welcome Jenny as she comes up? Over here, Jenny. You got a mic all to yourself. Oh, yeah, you do. So tell us, first of all, how long have you been a member of St. Matt's?
Oh, about 6 years, I think.
Six years. Wonderful.
Not a long time.
Not a long time. No. But tell us one thing that you've really loved about St. Matt's.
How friendly the people are and welcoming, and also the degree of teaching in the sermons. It's really, good depth. Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah, and I find that really good, really challenging.
Thank you, Jenny. Tell us a bit about where you're headed to next.
I'm headed to French's Forest so that I, in an over 55s development, so that I can be closer to my daughter, who is helping me a lot as my health deteriorates.
Wonderful. So you're not too far away geographically, but you'll be finding another church to go to.
I will, because I don't think I can get up that early.
Yeah. We appreciate that. Now, Jenny, as you go, do you have a word of encouragement or exhortation for us as a congregation?
Keep strong in your faith. Always think about other people who are here and the prayer they might need or help they might need. So I find that has been really wonderful for me, and I'm sure it will continue on, because people here are just so loving and kind and steeped, I think, in God's love.
Wonderful. Thank you. That's an encouraging word for us to continue in that. Jenny, let me pray for you. Will you pray with me?
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jenny, and we thank you for her invaluable contribution to this community over the last 6 years. We thank you that she's felt loved and welcomed, and that people have befriended her. And we thank you too that she has loved and befriended others. And we pray for her as she relocates. We thank you for her daughter who's helping her. And we ask that Jenny might quickly find another community of believers that she can fellowship with, that she will continue to grow in the knowledge and depth of your love for her. And we pray in this time of transition that you will comfort her and be with her, that she might know your presence and goodness, and that the friends that she has here will continue to support her as well. And we give you thanks and praise for Jenny and pray your blessing on her in this next season and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'd just like to thank my cousin in marriage, Miriam Bunn, who invited me to come here in the first place.
Wonderful, thank you. I don't think I knew that connection, but another little connection. They're everywhere around the place if you start looking. I'm going to invite Nancy now to come and read the Bible to us. Thanks, Nancy.
Thank you. Good morning. The Bible reading this morning is from 2 Timothy 3, 1 to 17, on page 1852 in your Bibles there. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. Have nothing to do with such people. They are the kind who worm their way into homes and gain control over gullible women who are loaded down with sins and are swayed by all kinds of evil desires, always learning but never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Just as Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses, so also these teachers oppose the truth. They are men of depraved minds who, as far as the faith is concerned, are rejected. But they will not get very far because, as in the case of those men, their folly will be clear to everyone. A final charge to Timothy. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra? The persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and impostors will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learnt it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is used for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Thank you.
Morning, everyone. It's special welcome. Special welcome if you are a guest here this morning and you're coming in on a really intense passage. Strap yourself in, I guess. I can just switch mics if you want. Where's the handheld? Thanks, Jenny. Hi. To those online, I just said hi. Don't worry about it. You missed nothing important. We are in the middle of a series in 2 Timothy. We just took a break for Easter, so let me do a quick recap and we'll dive straight in there. Paul has been establishing and strengthening churches around the Mediterranean. Sometimes things go wrong in those churches, and so he's sent his apprentice, his good friend Timothy, to the church in Ephesus to address some problems there, where there's these false teachers who have started leading people away from Jesus. But it's been a while. Timothy's work in Ephesus hasn't gone so well. The opposition has been strong, and Timothy feels weak. He's overwhelmed by the scale of the task before him. And making it worse, Paul can't come and help now because since Timothy went to Ephesus, Paul has been arrested and put in prison. So Paul seeks to encourage Timothy as best he can by writing him this letter. As Timothy is confronted by a task too great for him to handle on his own, Paul exhorts him to find a different strength. Rather than relying on his own wisdom, his own abilities, his own efforts, Paul reminds him that the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. He tells Timothy to be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, to find a different strength. And through this letter, God continues to speak to us too. And as we just heard, particularly in our reading for this morning, God teaches us where we can find a different strength when it feels like things in a church are falling apart. Where we can find a different strength when the church is under attack from within. Let's pray. God, we pray that you'd help us to understand this, to take the warning seriously, so that we can guard our church and follow Jesus together. Amen. Come with me to verse 1. Paul writes, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. When Paul says last days, he's not talking about the future. For New Testament writers, last days is the period in between Jesus' first coming and his second coming. He's essentially saying there will be terrible times while we wait for Jesus to come back. Terrible, meaning dangerous, perilous, deadly. That doesn't sound very encouraging, does it? And I said the whole purpose of this letter is to encourage Timothy. So how does that work? I have a very minor lingering injury that I've been ignoring for some time. About this week, I finally decided to go and get some treatment. And it was horrible. So bad. Oh my goodness. Most painful treatment I've ever had. But you know what helped? The healthcare professional, after he checked me out, he'd made a plan, he let me know, this is going to be really bad. That was genuinely helpful to hear so that I could prepare myself and my expectations for the next 30 minutes. And that's what Paul is doing here. He's trying to give Timothy realistic expectations so that Timothy knows what he's in for and he can plan accordingly. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. There will be terrible times because some people are going to be terrible. They'll be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. They'll be boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient. They'll be ungrateful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving. They'll be slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good. They'll be treacherous, rash, conceited. They'll be lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. That's quite a list, isn't it? We're not going to go through that phrase by phrase, but I just want you to notice how the list starts. They'll be lovers of themselves. That's where it all starts. That's where it all goes wrong. That's where the rest of the sin comes from this selfish preoccupation, this self-love. I mean, it sounds innocuous. What's the big deal? But self-love, misdirected love, love for self instead of love for others, when we leave it unchecked, that's when it leads to things like greed, to being boastful, to being proud, to being ungrateful, to being abusive because you think others exist just to meet your needs. And Paul warns Timothy to expect to encounter people like this. But to be clear, he's not telling Timothy to expect to generally encounter people like this. He's warning Timothy to expect to encounter people like this within the Christian community. In the last days, there will be terrible times when people inside the Christian community, when people inside churches act like this. Paul says in verse 5, these people will have a form of godliness, meaning they'll have an outward appearance of being close to God when actually they are far from Him. Paul goes on to describe them further. They are the kind who worm their way into homes and gain control over gullible women who are loaded down with sins and swayed by all kinds of desires, always learning but never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. Paul gets suspiciously specific here. And so I don't think he's talking about hypotheticals anymore. I think he's talking about the kinds of people that Timothy has already met in Ephesus. We know there is a big problem with false teachers in Ephesus. That's why Timothy was sent there. And we know from 1 Timothy that there was also a considerable problem with widows in Ephesus. The church had taken over financially caring for a whole lot of widows, which was a great thing. But some of those widows were taking advantage and had started behaving really poorly together. So my best reading of the situation Paul is alluding to here is that some of these teachers, these false teachers, were freeloading off vulnerable women in Ephesus. Freeloading off vulnerable widows, using their authority as Christian teachers, as spiritual leaders, to manipulate others into providing for their lavish lifestyles. And Paul hates this. He hates it. He's exasperated with these women who have let themselves be taken in, but he's furious with these false teachers that would exploit them. He's furious with these men of influence who are wrecking the church as they lead many away from Jesus. He says they are men of depraved minds who claim to be true followers of Jesus, but who have actually been rejected by Jesus. They are evildoers and imposters who go from bad to worse, deceiving others and being deceived. Paul's gotten really specific, and yet somehow his warning still sounds so relevant today. There are those in churches who will exploit others for their own gain. I had a professor during my training to be a pastor who wrote a book. He collected a bunch of true stories. The book's over there, but I'm not going to show you it now. He collected a bunch of true stories about misconduct by leaders in churches. It was not a fun read. He changed enough of the details to try and maintain anonymity for these churches. But he got us to read it so we could try and learn from all the mistakes that had been made. And he shared with us that he would get letters and emails again and again over the years with different people from different churches saying, "Oh, that chapter? That was about my church, wasn't it?" And in all the years of getting letters, he said only one time was a person actually right in identifying their own church. All the other people who had written in had just experienced very similar broken situations. There will be terrible times in the last days when people inside the Christian community will be motivated by self-love to deceive and exploit anyone they can. This is not just a warning from Paul to Timothy. Jesus talks about this as well. He says, "Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing. They look like they're part of God's flock, They have a form of godliness, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. That's pretty sobering, right? Jesus says from the very beginning of the church that there are going to be wolves, imposters, evildoers, deceivers, exploiters. Why is Paul going over all this with Timothy? So that he'll be alert, so that he'll be ready, so that he won't be taken by surprise, he won't be caught unawares, so that he won't underestimate the threat in front of him. He wants Timothy to survive these attacks from the wolves, and he wants Timothy to help protect others from these wolves too. But how is Timothy supposed to do that? He's already overwhelmed by the task before him. How is he supposed to protect himself and others? How can we protect ourselves and others from the influence of wolves in Christian communities today? In the second half of the passage, Paul tells us. I'll paraphrase it, but essentially, to survive those who are false, hold fast to the truth. To survive those who are false, hold fast to the truth. From verse 10, you, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, my faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. Paul holds himself out for scrutiny. He puts himself in direct contrast with the false teachers, and he says, Timothy, you know me. You know what I teach. You know how I live. You know how I have held fast to the truth. Then verse 14, as for you, Timothy, continue in what you have learned and in what you have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. Taken together, verses 10 to 14, Paul is telling Timothy to copy Paul's example. Just as Paul has clung to the truth in his teaching and in how he has tried to live his life, he wants Timothy to do the same. He wants Timothy to continue. Another way to translate that would be abide, stand firm, hold fast to the truth he knows about Jesus. To survive those who are false, hold fast to the truth. This continuing in the truth, holding fast to the truth, I think it has two aspects. First, holding fast to the truth involves an intellectual aspect, knowing and believing spiritual truth. A great way to be on guard against a liar is to know what's true. And so we should know the truth at St. Matt's. We should take the truth very seriously. We should study God's word rigorously together. But Ron's going to spend all of next week looking at the last couple of verses from this chapter, making that point, so I'll stop, Ron, sorry. For now, let's focus on the second aspect of continuing in the truth, actually living it out. Paul doesn't just point Timothy to what he teaches, but to his way of life, his purpose, his faith, his patience, his endurance, his love. He points Timothy to his own character as he seeks to live out the truth. But let's be honest, that doesn't sound particularly powerful, does it? I mean, the church in Ephesus is in trouble. They are going backwards. They are under assault. It's losing ground. Surely Timothy needs to get down in the dirt with these wolves and start fighting back. He needs a real strategy to beat them. But no, Paul doesn't tell Timothy to fight fire with fire. He doesn't tell him to make cunning plans. He doesn't tell him to play political games in order to win a leadership struggle. No, he tells Timothy to find a different strength. He tells Timothy to hold fast in his beliefs, hold firm in his character, and trust that God can work through that. To survive those who are false, hold fast to the truth. Maybe that still sounds a bit underwhelming, But let me suggest three ways that Timothy holding fast to the truth and how he lives his life could be powerful in protecting him and others against wolves. Number one, holding fast to the truth can expose the bad character of the false teachers. Jesus says that the best way to recognize a wolf is to look at their character. He says, by their fruit, you will recognize them. These false teachers in Ephesus should stand out because of their boasting, because of their greed, because of all these other sins that Paul has listed earlier. But bad character goes unrecognized where bad character is common. These women who are being exploited are in part so vulnerable because it seems like they've been giving very little attention to their own characters. This hasn't been a priority for them. And so they haven't been noticing that something is wrong with the characters of the ones exploiting them. Bad character goes unrecognized where bad character is common. Their selfishness should stand out, but instead it's just kind of blending in. But Timothy can make their selfishness stand out by being selfless himself. He can make their pride stand out by being humble. He can draw attention to their lack of love by being genuinely loving. There's strength in that. Now, the Ephesian church seems like it is in real trouble. The influence and impact of these false teachers has gone deep. And hopefully that's not the reality right now at St. Matt's. But the character of our leaders remains so important. Please keep encouraging leaders at St. Matt's to grow in godliness. And if you notice bad character in our leaders, if you observe a lack of growth in me or someone else that has influence, please raise it. Raise it. Help us to see it. People should have influence in a church not on the basis of how skilled they are, but on the basis of good character. Bad character cannot be allowed to flourish. But when you confront bad character, please do it with good character. Do it prayerfully, gently, kindly. There's strength in that. Number two, holding fast to the truth can be an example for others to follow. Just as Timothy can follow Paul, other Ephesians can follow Timothy. If the false teachers can lead people astray by how they are living their lives, then Timothy can lead people back by how he's living his life. Do you know how I learned to welcome people in? By being welcomed in. I have learned endurance by seeing other Christians endure. I've learned to confess my sin by hearing others confess theirs. I have learned to follow Jesus by following other followers. And I bet that's true for you too. And each time we learn from someone else's positive example, we're a little more anchored, a little less easily led astray. There's strength in that. And it brings us to number three. Holding fast to the truth can point people to Jesus. I keep looking at this passage and looking at how Timothy describes these women. They are loaded down with sins. What a painful, exhausting way to live. They so badly need someone who can share with them, not just share with them, but demonstrate to them the forgiveness that they can have in Jesus. Jesus who was crushed by the weight of our sins so that we could walk free. I keep looking at these people corrupted by self-love. People who settled for a weak, selfish love as they tried to fill that hole inside themselves, when instead they could have had the almighty love of Jesus fill them up to overflowing. Paul says that Timothy is in Ephesus to show people the forgiveness of Jesus. Timothy is in Ephesus to show people the love of Jesus. And when you hold fast to the truth, when you live it out with a character that resembles that of Jesus, you can point other people in our church to Jesus too. So that together we can spot a wolf from way off and ensure that they find no one to devour here. To survive those who are false, hold fast to the truth and find a different strength. Lord God, it is so tempting when we encounter people of bad character to respond in kind. But we pray that you would help us to trust that your way is good and right, and that there is strength in living out the truth. Lord God, we pray that at St. Matt's that would be more and more and more the norm, so that bad character would stand out here, so that wolves would be obvious, so that we can be on our guard and keep each other safe for that last day when we get to be with Jesus forever. Amen.
Commit ourselves with the fantastic song, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Let's pray. In the plain English version of the Bible, Romans 12:2 says, "Don't be like most of the people in the world that like to do bad things. You have to be different from them. You have to let God change the way you think so that you'll become new people. Then you'll be able to find out the things that God wants you to do, and you will do what is good and the things that really make God happy." Let's pray together. Almighty God, as we come together in prayer today, we approach you in humility because we know that you alone are holy, true, and just. Your ways are not our ways, neither our thoughts your thoughts. We praise you for persisting in your purposes, for keeping your promises, for remaining faithful despite the many times that people reject you, and for continuing to hold out your offer of friendship and forgiveness to people who are rebels and enemies. We know that this opposition is hurtful to you, and yet also in Jesus you have personally taken on the consequences that we deserve. You have not remained aloof and injured. Instead, you have taken the initiative and you have opened up reconciliation. You have remained steadfast and merciful. We praise you, Father God. We have been blessed by all that you give. We are worthy. You are worthy of so much thanks and praise. We hear today the words of Paul calling for us, like Timothy, to stand firm and not to be selfish, not to be lovers of ourselves, not to be lovers of our money, not to be lovers of our pleasure. To our shame, we admit that our thoughts and behaviour have not matched this standard. Like the hypocrites, we too have so easily given the impression of being religious and have not always lived in your Spirit's power. Please forgive us. Please remake us into new people who know and believe and demonstrate what it means to live to make you happy. Help us to be bold when we perhaps see the prosperity and success of the wicked. Help us to trust in you as we follow in the path of Jesus, who fixed his eyes on the promise and obeyed you to the end. Lord God, we pray for our troubled world. Jesus warned us there would be wars and rumours of wars, and there would be all kinds of disasters. We grieve as we live in these last days. We see senseless loss of life in our world, and we pray that this would come to an end. Please work amongst those in authority to give them a broader vision of their responsibility and a recognition of their accountability. Please prosper the work of judges and police, as well as politicians and diplomats. Please protect those who work to bring relief and justice and care for the weak and the powerless. In our community, we pray for those we know who are sick or troubled or unemployed or struggling with the cost of living. We pray that during this time, you'll be very real to these people, that they will be aware of your presence and care, and the peace that only you can bring. We especially ask for those who provide care and support, and we ask that you will give them strength and endurance and a gentle spirit. And we ask that you would please stir in us actions that we can take so that we are not just content to walk by on the other side of the road. We pray for our ministry team, and we thank you for their service. And we pray for John and David, who are sick at the moment. Please help them all to persist in godliness. May they be encouraged in their work as they seek to be creative and relevant, to be comfortable, to continue holding on to the same old truth of the gospel. Please motivate us to be engaged with and supportive of the activities of St. Matt's. We thank you for the financial gifts that have been contributed already, and we pray that the budget will be met so that what has been planned can continue. Father God, we know that following you may not always be easy or popular. Please help us to be confident in your goodness and wisdom. Please enliven us by your Spirit so that we will be known as those who clearly and happily live for your honour and glory. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we pray today for Susanna Baldwin, who's with us, working with Wycliffe Translators as part of the Australian Society for Indigenous Languages. Let's pray for Susanna. Lord God, we thank you that your word is alive and powerful, enabling us to know you and your ways. We thank you for the work of translators who work carefully to understand the original language of the Bible and the culture and words of modern people groups. We pray today for the work of the team producing the plain English version of the Bible. We thank you for the original vision of the group who established this work more than 20 years ago, seeking to write in a form of English which is more accessible to those from an Indigenous background. We thank you for the progress which has been achieved, including the publication of portions of the Bible in a single book. We pray for the recent booklets using that translation, which was used amongst children during Easter. And we ask that those who have read the stories and coloured in the pictures will have a deeper understanding of Jesus and his love for them. May they understand that what he has done is useful and relevant to their needs and their lives. And we ask with Susanna that there would be more translators able to join the team and to help progress the next phase of the work. We also pray for the team that you will give them patience, knowing that the whole process of translation and publishing requires careful attention and checking and can take a long time to complete. We thank you for all that you have already helped to bring about. May your word continue to speak of you and bring blessing and life to many peoples. We ask this in Jesus' name and for his honour. Amen.
Thanks, Mark. We're going to now spend some time sharing together in the Lord's Supper in Holy Communion. And just a few words of introduction. If you're visiting with us or new amongst us, practically the way we do this is we have four places where you can be served communion, two up the front, one on either side of me, and two up the back, one on either side. And mostly, depending on the quadrant of our building that you're sitting in, if you go to the station nearest you, that will be good. Go to that station through the centre aisle and return to your seats through the side aisle. Will prevent us from running into each other. And for those of you who are at the back, there's probably more of you up there than there is down the front. So if you'd just be mindful of how the line's going down here and perhaps you want to come down the front, I'll leave that to you to work out. What we're actually doing when we share the Lord's Supper together is proclaiming the Lord's death and resurrection, proclaiming that Jesus died and rose again. And if that's what you believe, that Jesus died and rose again to forgive the sin of the world, to give us hope of a new creation now and for all time, then you're very welcome to join with us in communion. If that is not what you believe, then you're very welcome to be a part of us. You may not want to join in communion because you're basically proclaiming something that you don't yet believe. And so we just encourage you to stay in your seats and continue to reflect on the things that you've been thinking about this morning. It's so good to have you with us. As we come to communion, there's so much going on here. It's such a rich thing for us to do. But I want to just urge you to think about or be mindful of two things as we share together this morning. One vertical, and that is to hold fast to the truth, which Chris has reminded us from God's word this morning. As we come to communion, let's remind ourselves of the truth that we're holding fast to and rededicate ourselves because of what Christ has done for us. And the other one is on the horizontal. That as we come to communion, we do it together. We share in this together. And it reminds us of the fellowship that we have because of Jesus. And so today, again, coming out of the message from the scriptures this morning, Let's recommit ourselves to loving one another. And so as you go to sharing communion, look at the faces of those around you and remind yourself of the call of Christ on us to love each other. And I think that will be helpful for us. I'm going to lead us in some prayers. I'm going to invite you to join us in the bold on the screen at various points, and then we'll share together in the Lord's Supper. Let's pray. We praise and thank you, Heavenly Father, for every spiritual blessing in Jesus our Lord, in whom we have the forgiveness of sins, the gift of your Spirit, and the hope of sharing in your glory. We who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of your Son. He loved us and gave himself for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Therefore, we lift our voices to praise you, saying together, glory be to God in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Then after the meal, he took the cup, and again giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Together. Father, we thank you for these gifts of your creation and pray that we who eat and drink them in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, believing our Saviour's word, may be partakers of his body and blood. Amen. Going to invite those who are helping to serve communion to come forward first, and then I'll invite the rest of you to join. Come, let us eat and drink in remembrance that Christ has died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Let's pray. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son Jesus and brought us home. Dying and living, Jesus declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. And may we whom the Spirit lights give light to this world. Keep us in this hope that we have grasped, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Amen. We're going to sing again. Thanks, Richard.
I can sing with my whole heart, I have all I need. In Jesus, my Saviour, my joy is complete.
Take a seat for a moment. Don't forget to pick up your kids. Share morning tea together. Say hi and encourage Susanna, who's visiting with us. Jan, our lovely Jan, will be in the prayer room this morning. Maybe we could have conversations together about how we hold fast to the truth and how we stand firm in Jesus in these last days. Like Paul's example, his teaching, way of life, purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecution, sufferings, all those things that he endured, yet he knew the Lord rescued him from all of them. In fact, we're to expect persecution as we lead a godly life. Father God, we pray that we will find a different strength, holding fast to the truth, living out the truth with good character, as Jesus' example, to continue in what we have learned and have been convinced of, knowing and believing the truth God has revealed to us, that we may point people to Jesus. Now, Lord, what do we look for? Our hope is in you. And now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Saviour, be glory and majesty, power and authority, both now and forever. Amen. Hold fast to the truth.